In this presentation, I will discuss the differences between how the eyes function and how the person functions. Visual functioning can be approached from different points of view. Each point of view will show us a different aspect. What is meant by speaking of aspects? When I show you this picture, do you see three objects here? Or could it be that you are just looking at three aspects of an unfamiliar object? Turning the object around to look at it from different points of view, we discover that what seemed different object may just be different aspects of the same object. To apply this to a practical situation, consider a patient with AMD who comes to the office to make an appointment. The front desk will think about when to schedule her. The doctor will think about which treatment to select. The office manager may worry whether the insurance will pay. The daughter worries whether mother can still drive. These considerations may seem to have little in common, yet they represent several different aspects of a single clinical case. Each aspect reveals not only something about the subject, but also about the point of view of the beholder. When we talk about vision and visual functioning, I have found it useful to consider four main aspects. First, we may consider various changes at the tissue level, such as scarring, atrophy, or loss. Here we need a pathologist to look at the structure of the organ. However, the structural changes do not tell us how well the eye actually functions. We need to broaden our view to include functional changes. We need a clinician to measure aspects such as visual acuity, visual field, and contrast sensitivity. Yet, knowing how the eye functions does not tell us how the person functions. So we need to widen our perspective again to consider tasks such as reading, mobility, activities of daily living. Here we need various low vision professionals to work with the patient. Beyond that, we need to look at the person in a societal context. Do these changes impact on the person's participation in society, causing a reduced quality of life? How can we be sure of a contented patient, since that is the end goal of all our interventions, and particularly of vision rehabilitation? One thing that we can already see at this point is that comprehensive care cannot be the job of one person. It needs a team of professionals, and the patient must be part of that team. I will use this schema in many of my slides. It is useful to draw a line in the middle. On the organ side, we describe how the eyes function, and we speak of visual functions. On the person side, we describe how the person functions, especially in regard to vision-related activities of daily living, and we speak of functional vision. Let us start with the patient's point of view. The patient comes in with a very practical complaint. Doctor, I cannot read. Her primary concern is on how she can function, on her quality of life, and on daily living skills. For her, the details of how her eyes function are of secondary interest. Compare that with the doctor's point of view. He immediately translates the patient's complaint to a statement about the eyes. The patient has lost three lines. His professional interest is on how the eyes function. For him, how the person functions is of secondary interest. Let us look a little further. When we think of eye doctors, the emphasis tends to be on letter chart acuity. That emphasis often is so strong that we refer to visual acuity as vision. Her vision is 20/40. When we shift to the patient side, the emphasis is on activities of daily living. In this context, we need to take into account many more aspects of vision, acuity, field, contrast, color, movement, etc. When we realize that, we must make the earlier statement more accurate by saying that her visual acuity is 20/40. One of the things the eye doctor must learn is that normal letter chart acuity does not mean that there are no vision problems. On the patient side, we are not done. When we normalized her eyes, we must also provide coping skills and tools. Not only do the left and the right side differ in their emphasis, they also differ in their objectives. When measuring how well the eyes function, the objective is to learn more about the underlying condition. When measuring how well the person functions, the objective is to learn more about the societal consequences. Rehabilitation provides a link between these two aspects. The complexity of the problems on the left and on the right is also different. On the left, where we deal with how the eyes function, there is a fairly straightforward pass from the object screen through the optics of the eye to the retinal image and on to the optic nerve signal. On the right, where we deal with how the person functions, we must deal with the interaction of visual demands and visual resources. It is only the balance between these two that determines functional vision. Traditional low vision care addresses mainly the optical aspects. When we want to provide comprehensive vision rehabilitation, however, we need to consider much more. Vision substitution skills, which offer non-visual skills such as braille, long cane, or speech output, can be important to enhance the resources. We also need to consider the task demands. For example, when we provide a student with a magnifier, we practice vision enhancement. When we provide large print, we modify the task. When we provide talking books, we practice vision substitution. Beyond these factors, we also must consider the environment. The human environment can be either supportive or prejudiced. The physical environment can provide barriers or facilitators. Finally, we must consider the individual's coping skills, which may affect how well all of our interventions are received and adopted. In summary, on the right, the number of variables and their interactions are much more complex than on the left. To summarize what this means for our assessment in vision rehabilitation, we can assess three main aspects: the organ, the person, and the societal context. Under organ function, we must deal with the parameters of visual functions. For the person, we must consider task performance and functional vision. In a societal context, we must consider vision-related quality of life. What do we consider under each of these headings? Under visual functions, we look at ocular functions such as visual acuity, visual field, contrast sensitivity, and so on. Under task performance, we look at activities such as reading, orientation and mobility, and activities of daily living. Finally, under quality of life, we look at attributes such as social skills and the ability to make and keep friendships. It should be clear that these groups are very different and therefore should be evaluated separately. The ways in which we evaluate each aspect are also very different. For organ functions, we can make exact threshold measurements, one parameter at a time. When looking at the activities and abilities of the person, we must always consider the interaction of multiple factors and ask for sustainable performance. Quality of life, finally, is a subjective experience which is hard to measure numerically. Satisfaction is an important goal. When planning rehabilitation, we must realize that one activity can span several aspects. Let us take reading as an example. Print size and reading speed, words per minute, reflect organ function. Reading endurance, how many hours a day someone can read, reflects an ability of the person. Reading enjoyment, finally, is a component of quality of life. Because these are different aspects, we need to assess them separately and with different tools. We cannot predict reading enjoyment from measuring print size and reading speed. Here are three familiar eye tests which measure different parameters: visual acuity, contrast sensitivity, and dark adaptation. Since we use separate tests, we may think of them as separate, unrelated parameters. They each determine a separate performance threshold, which is defined as 50% above guessing. Real-life situations, however, always involve multiple parameters. Detail varies, as does contrast, as does illumination. So we cannot get away with measuring one parameter at a time. Furthermore, we ask for sustainable performance. Threshold performance is not good enough for actual task. Let us look at more detail at some of the difference between assessing the functioning of the eye and assessing the functioning of the person. On the left, an example of a threshold measurement is letter chart acuity. We generally define threshold performance as 50% above guessing and pose no time limit. We have defined the reference standard as the ability to recognize a 1M letter at 1 meter. The requirements for reading on the right are a different matter. We require near 100% correct performance and a reasonable reading speed. When reading, we generally bring 1M print to about 40 centimeters, which is 2.5 times above threshold. That difference is not negligible. We mentioned the difference between a static, artificial environment and a dynamic one. This is the static criterion most countries set for a driver's license. This reflects actual driving performance. The difference is obvious. When measuring how the eyes function, we measure one parameter at a time. We know that size, contrast, and lighting all affect visibility. When we vary the size while keeping contrast and lighting constant, we have a letter chart and measure visual acuity. When we vary the contrast while keeping the other parameters constant, we measure contrast sensitivity. When we vary the lighting, we measure dark adaptation. Each of these separate measurements gives us a single number. On the right, where we deal with multiple interacting parameters, a single number does not suffice. We need at least a two-dimensional display. This diagram shows the interaction of contrast and detail and how it is captured by this contrast sensitivity curve. It shows that visual acuity and contrast are not independent variables. Better contrast results in better acuity. In summary, because of all of these differences, determining how the person functions is not just an extension of how the eyes function. The different aspects require different approaches and the efforts of different members of the vision rehabilitation team.